Alicia Dennis has been a bartender for 3 years. She's currently working at a local nightclub where she considers herself to be quite successful. Alicia says one reason for her success is the rapport she develops with her customers.
Where you from? You're not too far from home, are you? What, you guys in business or pleasure in Montgomery?
Business.
Pleasure too right now. Alicia says the old stereotype of the bartender as someone who listens to your problems is no longer accurate. Now she says most people come in to have a good time rather than discuss their problems. But what happens when some of the customers have had too much to drink and get unruly? You may think this petite young woman can't handle the situation, but Alicia says she can by talking to and humoring the customer. And if that doesn't work, she says all she has to do is ask them to leave. Most bartenders have a certain drink they make better than others. Alicia says her drink is a pina colada.
Pina coladas, you're supposed to put a certain amount of cocoa and a certain amount of pineapple juice. And I rearranged my recipe. I put a lot more coconut than pineapple, and people seem to like it better that way.
Alicia says she also does a lot of experimenting to see what types of combinations she can come up with. So what do you do when you come in contact with a bartender's special brew, or you've had too much of your own brand? Alicia says take 2 aspirin and sleep it off. If you can't do that, sweat it off or drink plenty of Gatorade. But she says, whatever you do, don't drink water, because it'll make you sicker. Cassandra Taylor, WSFA TV News.
We have placed on the street approximately 30,000 of the new containers, curbside containers. We have made provision for those people who are handicapped or aged or who are infirm for one reason or another, who cannot get out and move their curbside container to the street. That's running about 1% of the population. There are a few people who would like to have their garbage picked up in their kitchen instead of at the back door. And we've had some complaints there. But by and large, and I would say in the 97% to 98% category of the city of Montgomery, they recognize that, one, it's a good service, and two, that it will save them, the taxpayers of the city of Montgomery, money by implementing this system. We are finding that we can do what we thought we would do, and that is one crew can now double its productivity by the curbside service. In other words, a crew that was picking up 450 households a day with the old backyard service is now in the 850 to 900 range, thereby doubling its productivity. So I think it's working, and I'm real pleased with it.
It's been obvious from some reports coming out of City Council that there's an ongoing squabble between you and certain members of the Montgomery City Council. Do you see that as continuing, or do you see a possible reconciliation?
Well, might as well say it like it is. Mr. Reed and I could hardly agree that Christmas is a nice day. I've said publicly, and I say it again, his every action and every motive is based on some aspect of race. There's no way there can be a reconciliation between our positions. I believe that everybody ought to be treated equally, and that everybody ought to have, as I say, equal treatment. He wants preferential treatment, and as far as I'm concerned, and as long as I'm mayor, he won't get it. There's no way that our political differences could ever be reconciled, because I certainly don't intend to move over to his side.
Dr. Vaughn, the keynote speaker for Montgomery's 118th anniversary of the Emancipation Proclamation celebration, says blacks must develop strong economic, political, and social plans and must pass them along to the next generation. He says by design and not by accident, blacks must be strong forces in the Republican and Democratic Party. Vaughn, instrumental in ASU's grants from the Kellogg Foundation, says if President-elect Reagan claims he's a strong advocate of an effective free enterprise system and he desires a close relationship with third world nations, he must include black America.
You know, 75% of the world's population just happens to be non-white. If in the free enterprise system, blacks are disproportionately unemployed, if he is a low man on the totem pole, if he gets all of the responsibilities and none of the rewards of the system, then the system is not likely to attract those countries of the world who are now shopping for a system that will work best for them. The real test for an economic system is not the extent to which it gives to those who have, but the extent to which it provides opportunities for those who have not.
Today marks the 27th observance by the Montgomery Freedom Movement of the Emancipation Proclamation anniversary. Dr. Ralph Abernathy served as its first president. T.L. Crenshaw is the current president. George Mitchell, WSFA TV News.
Have won this game today.
We find it very difficult to defeat a good football team with turnovers. That was something that we didn't have this year during the year, and we had too many today, obviously.
The defense tougher than you thought, Coach?
No. We felt like they were awfully good defense. They were the best in the nation last year, and they ranked very high, and they're awfully good defensively. No, they're as good as we thought they were.
Coach Steph and his staff for any player deserve a lot of credit. And we just tickled death to get out of here winning. I'm proud of them for just winning the road.
They were not as big as teams we've played in the past. And so I just looked at it this way. They're going to be extremely quick. So we had to work on our quickness also. But in a lot of instances, we just overpowered them.
You didn't get to the quarterback, but some of your guys did.
Yeah, I got to him about once. I got to him once. But everybody else, you know, it was a team effort. We all got in there together. We even placed some bets who would get back there first.
Are your team, the seniors this year, going out a winner? We've had four tremendous years. Lost four ball games in 4 years. I don't know, I've met a lot of people and got a lot of great friendships, and I hope they never die.
I don't think we accomplished our fullback too good. I think they took that away from us. And I guess that's what's really important is our fullback, and we just broke down on that.
We just played heads up, and we played over our heads a little bit, I think. We went out there and did things that we needed to do right to win the game, and we didn't make that many mistakes. We tried to cause turnovers, and that made the difference in the ball game.
This is Phil Snow reporting from Dallas, Texas.
You want the job?
Oh, I'd love to have the job. I think Auburn is you know, one of the finer universities, you know, in the country. They've always had a great tradition athletically and academically, and I'm definitely interested. In my part of the country, I'd love to get, you know, back over that way.
What part is your country?
Well, I'm from America's Georgia, and, of course, I had a lot of people when I was in school, in high school, that I competed against that went to Auburn, and they still recruit a great, you know, deal of their football players from Georgia.
You have any explanation why they've taken such a long time?
No, I really don't. But the longer they take, you know, the more I get my hopes up because, you know, I'm committed to, you know, with the Cowboys until as far as we go, and I hope that's a long ways. And the longer they wait, the better I like my chances of, you know, at least being considered for the job.
Well, first of all, I stoutly support the First Amendment to the Constitution, that people ought to be able to freely assemble and to peacefully demonstrate their views. I strongly support that. Now, when it ceases to be peaceful, I intend to make sure that it does not upset the tranquility of this city. A year ago, when the Klan came to town, arrested 197 of them. Because they were armed, they did not have a permit, they didn't seek a permit, they did everything wrong. This time they came to town, they obeyed our laws, we made sure that they obeyed them. We put enough police around them to where no external force could bother them and they couldn't bother anybody else. They held their rally and left. I'm not bothered by any group whose views might differ from mine assembling and making their views known. No, that doesn't bother me. But where anybody comes in that might create a situation where violence would be associated with it, City of Montgomery and the Montgomery Police Department will deal with it swiftly and suddenly and with a great deal of finality.
Cecil Cash says he grew tired of punching a time clock and working swing shifts at a mill. So when he got the chance to purchase the equipment to make chairs, he took it. This is how he spends his days. He can work 16 hours or he can spend the day just rocking in a rocking chair. He says he doesn't usually have the time to rock, but instead spends his time making chairs for other people to use. Cash grows his own trees and takes the wood to a local mill to have it cut to his specifications. He says the right kind of wood is becoming more difficult to find. Trees must be cut at just the right time of maturity to produce a good product. Cash began making rocking chairs and straight back chairs as a hobby. But when he bought his lathe and other equipment from the family of a friend, the customers came too. There aren't many Cecil Cashes who make large, sturdy rocking chairs. He makes the chair frames, and his wife, Mary, weaves the backs and seats. Cash says his business earns him a living. He plans to eventually add the pottery his father-in-law makes to his line of merchandise. That's a story we covered last Tuesday. Reporting from Lolly on Highway 183 in Chilton County, George Mitchell, WSFA TV News.
In the past 4 years, agriculture has only seen one relatively good year in Alabama now in production, and that was the effect that we would have had there, where the farmers had adequate supplies to sell, was offset by the embargo which was put on when Afghanistan was invaded by the Soviet Union. So that, coupled with tremendously high production costs that have just, you know, risen higher than, faster than the rate of inflation on the farm, fuel, seed, fertilizer, machinery, all of it has gone up just tremendously. And we find ourselves in a situation where the net income to farmers in 1970 was about $12 billion. The net income income to farmers in 1980 was about $12 billion. And you just can't exist with the increases in costs that we've had at the same levels.
Most of the furniture is still waiting to be moved in, and Denton has yet to select a complete staff, but that didn't stop him from officially taking office on this day. His head start was made possible when outgoing Senator Don Stewart voluntarily resigned his seat a day early so that Denton and the state of Alabama might benefit from any advantages of seniority. As his wife and chief assistant looked on, Denton took the oath of office.
I, Jeremiah Denton, do solemnly swear that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, that I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same, that I undertake these duties without mental reservation or fear of evasion, and that I will well and faithfully discharge the duties of the office on which I am about to enter. So help me God.
Actually, today's ceremony was largely symbolic. The fact that Denton now has at least one day seniority over many of his freshman colleagues does not mean as much as it once did. What it does mean is that Denton is now officially in office and able to start work on some of the many campaign pledges he made back during the summer and fall. For WSFA TV News, I'm Bruce Finlan in Washington.
Farm Bureau officials say the rising cost of food reflects the increase on everything, and they predict prices will continue to increase well into the new year. Prices on protein items such as beef, pork, and poultry had the most noticeable increase in the past 2 years. And future prices, according to one Farm Bureau official, depend on this year's recovery season.
Hopefully, we'll have a good agricultural season, good production season, and the plantings will adequately build us a grain reserve and hold a good prospect for future years. I think right now we're in a situation where if we do not have a good year this year, the increases worldwide now, if the major agricultural producing countries of the world do not produce adequately, we'll be in a position where we'll see astronomical prices.
Fifield says 1980 was the worst year he's seen for farmers in 30 years.
We find ourselves in a situation where the net income to farmers in 1970 was about $12 billion. The net income income to farmers in 1980 was about $12 billion. And you just can't exist with the increases in costs that we've had at the same levels.
Even if this year's production is good, Fifield says it will still take 5 years for farming in Alabama to recover. Jane Matheson, WSFA TV News.
on the field, the Alabama defense was just too tough for the Baylor Bears. Turnovers or no, Baylor would not have won this game today.
We find it very difficult to defeat a good football team with turnovers. That was something that we didn't have this year during the year, and we had too many today, obviously.
The defense tougher than you thought, Coach?
No, we felt like they were awfully good defense. They were the best in the nation last year, and they ranked very high, and they're awfully good defensively. No, they're as good as we thought they were.
Coach Steff and his staff, any player deserve a lot of credit. And we just tickled after to get out of here winning. I'm proud of them for just winning the road.
They were not as big as teams we've played in the past. And so I just look at it this way. They're going to be extremely quick. So we had to work on our quickness also. But in a lot of instances, we just overpowered them.
You didn't get to the quarterback, but some of your guys did.
Yeah, I got to him about once. I got to him once. But everybody else, you know, it was a team effort. We all got in there together. We even placed some bets who would get back there first.
Are your team, the seniors this year, going out a winner? We've had four tremendous years, lost four ball games in 4 years. I don't know, I've met a lot of people and got a lot of great friendships, and I hope they never die.
I don't think we accomplished our fullback too good. I think they took that away from us. And I guess that's what's really important is our fullback, and we just broke down on that.
We just played heads up, and we played over our heads a little bit, I think. We went out there and did things that we needed to do right to win the game, and we didn't make that many mistakes. We tried to cause turnovers, and that made a difference in the ball game.
This is Phil Snow reporting from Dallas, Texas.
Yeah, he is a good one. We're watching him on film this morning, and it's unbelievable the way he hits people and takes hits. I mean, guys hit him, and he doesn't go down, just keeps on running. And I get the impression that he's very elusive, but he also likes to hit people, too.
He's a very good running back. He's one of the best backs I've seen this year. And not only does he have good running ability, he uses blockers well. You know, most of that linemen just fired and tried take you wherever you want to go, and he uses his blocks and make a cut, and he's gone. He's a very good back.
Well, he really is. He's no question the finest, you know, fullback in the National Football Conference. He's had a great year this year as well as the last couple of years, and he's a great blocker, good pass receiver, and an outstanding runner. So he's done an excellent job, you know, for Atlanta, and it's going to be a tough job for us to stop him.
The familiar sound of Sweet Georgia Brown. That means the Harlem Globetrotters can't be far away. For 54 years, the Globetrotters have been entertaining people of all ages all over the world. Their crazy antics on the basketball court have become an institution, a tradition of the American way. Why? Because the Globetrotters offer something that we don't get every day, good, wholesome family entertainment. Former Trotter Joe Cunningham was in Montgomery recently, and he remembered for us his playing days.
Well, I think what intrigues me more than anything else about the organization and the team itself is the magnitude, I think, that they have over people, that way of capturing an audience, making the audience a part of what's going on out on the floor. I think that's the most amazing thing. And then we can have players like a Twiggy Sanders and a Lou Dunbar who's only been with the team for 6 or 7 years that can really come out and be stand-up comedians almost and really be the type of entertainers that you really don't expect basketball players to be.
Cunningham joined the team to play basketball, but soon got caught up in the close relationship between the Trotters and their fans. He says as long as kids are being born, the Globetrotters will exist. They need each other, says Cunningham. So 7 days a week, each day in a different city, Harlem Globetrotters will continue to do the things they've been doing for more than half a century.
Yes, that was that cat, all right.
Thank you.
The team, the seniors this year going out a winner. We've had four tremendous years. Lost four ball games in 4 years. I don't know, I've met a lot of people and got a lot of great friendships, and I hope they never die.
You didn't get to the quarterback, but some of your guys did.
Yeah, I got to him about once. I got him to him once. But everybody else, you know, it was a team effort. We all got in there together. We even played some bets who would get back there first.
Are you getting ready to start chasing quarterbacks for money?
Hopefully. Hopefully somebody wants me.
Don't you think somebody might want you?
My mama want me. She wants me. She haven't seen me in Lord knows how long.
Did you say hello to your sister while you were out here?
Yes, I got to see her. She was under the weather for a while, but she's doing a lot better now. She made it to the game.
Has it been a good trip for you, Byron?
It's been a real good trip. Yeah.
You like Texas?
I like Texas. I've been out here before.
Merry Christmas. It's the best Christmas present I ever got. Yeah. It means life, and I wish everybody could get one that needed one.
What 18-year-old Trina had got was a new kidney. She was born with kidney problems, and in October, they failed completely. She waited for a kidney donor, and on Christmas night, a perfect match was found. A Shreveport, Louisiana man who had been killed in an accidental shooting.
Kidneys were removed on Christmas Day, and we received the call. Of course, after we received the call, we arranged transportation for the kidney to be sent to Birmingham here at the organ bank. We got the kidney late that evening. It was transplanted the following day.
Kraft credits the securing of the perfect match and the speed with which it was transported to Birmingham to the working relationship UAB has with the LSU hospital and other facilities across the country. To Trina, this is the beginning of a new life and a chance to accomplish things she's only been able to dream of.
It's the greatest gift you can ever give, because, like, what's it going to mean to somebody else after they're dead? And this is going to give me a whole new life. And the man that donated the kidneys is from Shreveport, Louisiana. And if he would have died, it's like a living memorial. You know, maybe his life, I can go on and do something good, you know, whereas his life was stopped and he can't do anything else good, you know, for the world. But I can now, and I'm going to.
Trina has a new car and a new apartment waiting on her in Montgomery. She should be out of the hospital in 5 weeks.
Some people feel that the family as an institution is going downhill. What are your thoughts about that?
There's never been a culture that wasn't a dead-end culture, that didn't have some form of family, whether they call it pair bonding or whatever they called it. I think the family of the future will change. It will not be the traditional father the breadwinner, mother the stay-at-home homemaker, and children. It will be all various possibilities. There will be single-parent families. There will be families made up of people who are not related, who are living together because they are friends and having their children share the same household. There'll be all possibilities, but it still will be people relating to others and caring about others. And when we have a home base, that family feeling, then we're better able to deal with the strangers in the world.
These pine trees add to what museum officials say they hope will someday be a whole avenue of trees. Boy Scout Troop 101 planted the trees, which represent the ones on the museum's flag collection.
The idea is to beautify the property and make it more appealing to the public. Some of the flags we have pictures of trees on them. Some of the pre-revolutionary flags have, there are a number of them that have pine trees of different heights and sizes on them, combined with the colors of the state that the soldiers came from.
Tumbling Waters Museum of Flags has enhanced Montgomery's culture for 5.5 years. This building downtown is its third location. The first tree was planted here last year.
We had a planting and did this magnolia behind you that was done on Arbor Day and had a ceremony.
Museum officials say they'll continue to add to the avenue of trees as long as they get the needed donations. They plan to add the next batch of trees this coming Arbor Day. Jane Matheson, WSFA TV News. There's more to today's calendar than just the date. The 12-month diary has evolved into quite an art form, reflecting current trends, movies, popular sports, and famous pigs. That divine swine, the Miss Piggy calendar for 1980, is the hottest-selling calendar, according to bookstore retailers. Many say it's the whimsical charm of Miss Piggy that lures in many of her fans. Retailers say calendars were also popular gifts this past Christmas. The yearly memo ranges in price from $5 to $15 and size to the smaller desk model to larger calendars that stretch across the wall. Bookstore manager Paige Paniagua says calendars have changed dramatically over the years. She says people are no longer buying the floral or picturesque models, but the ones that reflect shoppers' lifestyles.
They become more interesting, less floral, less picturesque, more adapted to motion picture interests and book interests and other personal interests that you'd have, like the Miss Piggy calendar.
Miss Paniagua says people are willing to pay almost any price for a calendar that not only attracts the eye, but helps them keep up with those very special dates. Kim Davis, WSFA TV News. Auburn University officials announced the Tigers' new head football coach today. He's former Wyoming coach Pat Dye. A search committee recommended Dye as head coach Friday afternoon, and the Auburn Board of Trustees approved the recommendation Friday night. Auburn officials made the announcement today at a press conference in Auburn. In other news this week, the Public Service Commission decided to put off Alabama Power Company's request to set new rates and rules governing the cogeneration of small power production. Cogeneration rates affect companies and persons generating their own power, such as windmill owners and paper and steel companies. Meanwhile, Governor Fob James said the PSC has organization problems. The governor says the present setup of three administrative bosses is crazy. James says the staff needs to answer only to one person. The governor says he's working with the legislative committee on some ideas for restructuring the commission. The city council met this week. One of the topics discussed was the shooting of a car theft suspect who allegedly pointed a gun at police officers. Mayor Emery Fulmer told the council that the shooting was a mistake, but that the officers acted according to their training. Fulmer said he was sorry the incident happened, and he said the city would do all it could for the family and the injured man, who it turns out was not the car thief. A man convicted of trying to bribe a state official had his prison sentence delayed on Wednesday. Ron Williams of Tuskegee was supposed to begin his 2-year sentence that day. Williams claims he didn't get a fair trial because he received no preliminary hearing and because there was only one black on the jury. One magistrate already refused the stay before Circuit Judge Randall Thomas delayed the sentence until January 16th when he'll hear a probation request. The Joint Interim Committee studying Medicaid discussed avoiding last year's financial difficulties this week. The state had been behind in its Medicaid payments to providers, such as pharmacists. Governor James blamed the deficit on overregulation by the federal government. So now the interim committee is trying to get more state control over the Medical Services Administration. An onslaught of fires in Montgomery gutted some houses, injured a few firemen, and even claimed one life this holiday week. The victim was 42-year-old Oldis Lee Wilson, who firemen found dead in his room during the fire. Police say the body was not burned, and they say the man had been dead for several hours before they found him. Finally, New Year's Eve was relatively quiet in Montgomery. Fortunately, there were no traffic fatalities. And Amy Michelle Mims was the first baby born here in the new year. Jane Matheson, WSFA, TV News.
Pat Dye, a Georgia farm boy with a knack of winning college football games, is Auburn University's 22nd head football coach. Dye, who resigned his job at Wyoming to pursue the Auburn job, met newsmen this afternoon. He has a 4-year contract which contains a clause that will prevent him from moving to any other SEC team during that contract period. No financial terms made public, but Dye said he did not take the job for money. He took it for the opportunity to coach at a great university in his part of the country.
It is what I consider one of the top jobs in the South. It is a school that has tremendous football tradition, and it is a school that I remember playing against and watching my older brothers play against back in the 50s and having coached against the University of Auburn at times when they were certainly a feared football power in the South. And I'm confident that with the support of the Auburn people, the alumni, the former players, the student body, the faculty, the administration, that we will be able to bring this great football tradition back to what it once was. And we're looking forward to this challenge with great anticipation, a lot of enthusiasm, and realizing fully that it is going to take a lot of hard work and probably a lot of patience on your part and our part, but we will get the job done in the end.
Dye was asked if he at any time became frustrated during the long wait as the search committee interviewed other prospective coaches.
Not really. I was born and raised on a farm, and when you watch those crops grow, you learn to be patient.
Dye said he will bring four or perhaps five of his assistants from Wyoming, and he will talk with members of the present Auburn staff. Auburn's athletic director, Lee Haley, who has not participated in the search for a new coach, accompanied the official party into the news conference. When asked if that was significant, Auburn president Dr. Hanley Funderburk said, "Pat Dye is our football coach. Lee Haley is our athletic director." This is Phil Snow reporting from Auburn.
President Carter and Rosalind for their kindness to me and to Joan and to our family. This kind and good man, this president, has permitted me to work more closely with him than any vice president in American history, and I thank him profoundly for that experience. Regrets, for I've learned in this office, as I could in no other way, about our country's richness and our world's promise. I've been moved by the majesty of our continent, lifted by the strength of our people, buoyed by the gift of their wit, touched by the decency of their spirit, and stretched by the reach of their hope. And tonight,